I have to take my medication for my herpes.
I looking forward to talking to TJ Miller and a couple of few. I was had a hectic morning up doing Zoom and did Artie Lang's show. And
how's he doing?
He's doing good.
Good.
I mean, by Artie Lange's standards, if that was a family member, you'd have a medevac to the closest triage center. But for Artie,
good.
Thriving.
So I had this thing, which is, you know, when you do the press gets all kind of backed up against one another. So I had a Zoom with Dan Patrick in the morning, who I enjoy. You forget about Dan Patrick. He's very smooth, and very nice.
He's a pro's pro.
He's a pro's pro. And then I was calling into Clay Travis and Buck Sexton. Clay's been up on stage with us in Nashville. I saw him at Cousin Sal's 50th party. He was doing Outkick and doing Cousin Sal's show and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, they took over for Rush Limbaugh. So they have like 400 affiliates. They're this huge... radio station, syndicated radio show. And so that hit time was 9:34. So I know the radio clock. Mm-hmm. And when they go, oh, your hit time's at 9:30. No, at 9:36.
You're still in the spot break at 9:30.
They're break at the bottom of the hour, at the top of the hour. And sometimes they just go calling at 9. But if it's ever, it's never 9, it's 9:04, which means you're going live at 9:05. And at this case, 9:34 meant your hit is at 9:35 with this 400 stations, this huge syndicated show. So I was like, okay, good. Circle that one on the calendar. And then I do Dan Patrick is at 9:10, 9:15, but the hits for only about 10 or 12 minutes. So I got about 4, 5, 6 minutes in between. And because my goddamn phone is spotty at my house at best. I'm like, you know what I'm going to do with this Buck and Clay and their 400 affiliates? I'm going to run down and hop in my car.
Smart.
And just sort of circle the neighborhood.
What could go wrong?
Great. It works great in the car. The reception is great. It's no good in my office. Yeah. But the Zoom works in the office. So then I'll run back and I'll do Artie's Zoom from the office. So I'm on with Dan, and, you know, I don't know, call him an old friend, but I've substituted, hosted his TV show and radio show before, and it's been a while. And so, you know, starts off, and it's not in Dan's show. It's a separate taped piece. So it's like I get there, we zoom in, and they go, oh, we'll go get Dan. And so Dan's not on a clock, you know. But Dan's a pro, and he knows it's like 12 minutes with a hard out. And we do the interview, and we start a couple minutes late. The Zoom's a little wanky. I get it on the computer. It's not working right with the phone because the office and whatever. You know, I'll go get Dan. Dan takes a minute or so, sits down. But we're doing 10, 12 minutes. It's 9:15, 9:16. Still going to give me time to jump here and then run down to the car for my 9:34 hit with Clay and Buck. And we talk, interview goes good, and at 9:27, we wrap. Mm-hmm. I'm like, all right, now I got a few minutes to get my shit together and get down to the car, and we wrap, and then Dan's like, hey, what's that picture up behind you? I'm in my office, and it's Paul Newman in his 9:35 painting, right? I go, oh, it's a 9:35 Porsche. I can't resist. I don't want to go.
Sweet siren
beeswax. Stay in your lane, Dan.
You're the Bond villain explaining evil plot.
Talk sports. I'm like, 9:35, 1979, first in class, second overall, Lamar, Paul Newman driving, Rob Stumlin, also driving, Dick Barber. And he goes, oh, okay. And I'm like, all right, Dan, good talking to you, buddy. And he goes, I got a 911 turbo. And I go, okay.
Shit.
Now, you've never heard me do this. I'm like, oh, there you go. Well, that sounds sweet. Okay, then. And he goes, man, that thing's got some power, man, when those turbos spool up. And he's just kind of leaning back in his seat.
He's kibitzing.
It's Dan Patrick. Yeah. I don't want to slam the computer shut on him. And I'm going, yeah. Good. Love me. And then he's like, is it Porsche or Porsche?
No time.
And I'm like, I have every answer, but I can I got up. Now I'm looking at the clock. It is 9:32 at this point, and I want to be in my car in 2 minutes or so.
And he's engaging you in a conversation that you would murder someone to have on a daily
basis.
We
would still be on right now if I did not have this. So, and I'm, he's like, yeah, man, I love that night. I love that turbo, man. But you're putting your foot in it, man, and that turbo spools up, man. It pulls you back in your seat. I'm like, well, okay, there you go.
I wouldn't know.
Sweet.
Know.
Sounds fun. I'm more of a Tesla guy.
Like a seductress.
This is whatever Lola wants,
like,
Lola gets.
Reaching for the computer, trying to do the tilt, slam shut. I'm like, right, here we go. And he's got nothing but time because he's just sitting in a studio and he's done with his show. And we're gonna put this one in tomorrow's show. And he wants to talk Porsches and Newman. And, you know, he's in that demographic. He knows
Paul
Newman.
I heard you're a real Porsche guy. Is that true?
Yeah.
Paul Newman raced horses?
Porsche,
raced
Kia, time? Kia Porsche, whatever. That's a four wheels and a running board. I don't care.
Hey, ever been to one of them auctions?
Livestock? No. just bring it home. Yeah, so, you've never heard me not want to talk about Porsches and race cars. And then when he, of course, bought the turbo Porsche and wants that guys who just get their cool cars want to talk about what it felt like to open them up and stuff. And I was just like, all right, bring it home.
And you know what Dan Patrick thought? That Adam Carolla is such a poser. He pretends he's into cars. Yeah. He wanted to get off the phone because he didn't know anything
every
about
detail,
it.
Huh?
Air-cooled, water-cooled, four-cylinder. What is that, four-banger? Pop the hood. Let me take a look under it. Oh, it's in the back.
It's in the trunk. Oh,
what?
Interesting.
So that was telling and funny. Artie's doing good. Artie was in good spirits. The camera was just kind of the one surveillance one that's kind of up in the corner. It's a little bit of distance away. Looked okay from the distance I was, but there was that. I also it's been fully 10 minutes since I brought it up, but the new application for the attack crows are these mobs that are attacking all these stores and outlets and everything, right? I mean,
That's easy.
You're a jeweler and you've got the whole glass display and you're out on Rodeo Drive and you got six of those bad boys just sitting on the perch.
Yeah,
and
they're already there.
Anyone who gets too close to that front door during closing hours, boom.
Death from above.
Easy.
Works, right?
Yeah. And I don't even think you need one crow per thug if, I don't want to get Obama in trouble. Mm-hmm. But I think a couple per, like, four dudes will cause enough chaos.
Well, you can have the birds that, because all these stores are typically grouped in an area. You know, you have the 12 birds for 50, four blocks, you know what I mean? Or per intersection or whatever.
You get one per gaggle of thugs.
Mm-hmm. That's what they're called, a gaggle of thugs.
A flock of thugs. I think you're good because it's... The whole reason the bird works is the randomness of
it.
It's we don't know who the bird's going for.
Right.
So and they're pretty clustered. The looters are pretty tight. So all you have to do is hit the path.
It's like a mall cop. He doesn't guard one store, he guards them all. The birds would guard an intersection or a block or whatever.
That is the truth. So at some point this is gonna happen. Look, when they do the non-lethal, it's non-lethal, but someone gets hit in the eye with a rubber bullet and is blinded.
Well, didn't a few guys lose eyes?
Yeah, and you could crack a rib or two easily.
They pick up the smoke canister and they throw it back at the cops. Like it's not very clean.
Yeah.
I say the crows are clean. They're non-lethal. I mean, they can't kill anybody.
Right.
They just send them running the other way.
Scare the shit out of people. Yeah.
And, someone would take great umbrage to it, but it would be insanely effective.
And they're doing what they love. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like, they're circus animals. They're doing bird things.
They're attacking black people, right.
That's
it's
like
in their DNA.
Much like the German Shepherd in the military. Like you think, oh, this animal's going to be... No, they're beloved members of the force.
I completely agree, and it's like the dogs that are looking for cocaine and gunpowder at the airport. They're looking for their toy.
Right, exactly,
they're
the prize.
They're not coke addicts, and they're not into law enforcement. They're looking for something else.
I only see one major problem with this in the future, and it's all headlines. Mm. A murder of crows when somebody gets killed.
We'll rebrand them.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. So Dawson just got back from Jack in the Box. And
is this drop? Did I play a drop? Feels like this would apply to almost any day.
The question went out, which is, who eats at Jack in the Box during the daylight hours?
Mm. Yeah, like sober.
They've been relegated to nothing else is open. Right. It's 4 a.m. I need some non-taco tacos.
Right.
But not Dawson. What'd you grab there, Dawson?
I got two tacos and a jumbo jack. It's very simple, easy lunch.
What's a jumbo jack?
Can we call those tacos? Standard, like, you can't call sparkling wine that's not from the Champagne region. Champagne.
You mentioned this before. A long time ago, Jack in the Box tacos are simultaneously the best and the worst tacos in the world.
Don't they like deep fry a whole taco?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's preformed. And
the meat, it's just soy protein. It's not meat.
And it's got American cheese, which normally doesn't make its way into a taco, but it is its own food.
It's its own category.
Group.
Yeah. And the best time to go, too, is like 12:15. On a weekday, because they got that they changed that oil. The tacos are fresh.
Oil.
Do not order tacos at 3 p.m.
Lunch
or 2:30.
Like getting your sushi on a Monday.
The oil's been corrupted. Oil's,
as soon as that oil gets corrupted, you can taste it.
And the Jumbo Jack, is that holding up?
Yeah, they messed up the Jumbo Jack about 10 years ago. They added ketchup to it, and it was never a ketchup burger.
Mm.
And so now when I order the Jumbo Jack, I gotta say no ketchup.
Oh, uh-huh. Fool me once.
And they're able to pull that off.
That's still a great burger. Yeah, yeah, they figured it out.
Wow.
Yeah, they can do it.
You know, you guys remember I was a secret shopper for Jack in the Box.
Yes,
in my chubbier days. And that was one of the things we had to test each restaurant on is where they customize the sandwich. You know, will Jumbo Jack hold, in this case, ketchup?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you grade them on how well they got your order right.
Wow. Did you eat everything that you secretly shopped for?
It was a rule that you had to taste everything that you got, at least one taste. And I was poor and fat, so you can imagine how long I made that last.
Overachiever.
Like, you know, if I'm doing a run on Tuesday, I'm going to three Jack in the Boxes in the Chino Hills area. Mm-hmm. Oh, those Jumbo Jacks are coming home with me.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah, they're getting reconstituted.
I was watching TV. I think I was watching football. And when TJ pops up, you can tell me, Max Pan.
Will do.
I was watching football on Sunday, and a PSA-type secondhand smoke commercial came up that we could not find anywhere, but I filmed it on my phone. But it's kind of a lot of glare on the TV set and that kind of stuff. But I think you can hear it just you can hear it just fine. And I think there's a theme that emerges. First off, they lie about everything, but I'll play the secondhand smoke commercial.
Every day over 100 Americans die from secondhand smoke.
Untrue.
Secondhand smoke in children can cause asthma,
ear infections.
Sids. Don't bury the lead.
The little black kid is being poisoned by the white guy smoking in the unit underneath. I just love that theme of Whitey's now poisoning black people because he's smoking in his apartment unit underneath it. Although when they do the exterior shot, it's kind of, they need the establishment apartment building.
Yeah.
It could be a single family.
Yeah, living downstairs.
He could have his black kid living upstairs. I don't know.
We need more clarification.
This shameful black bastard he's trying to kill with cigarette smoke.
But also, they got to get the HVAC system working correctly because it doesn't really work where one unit, you can't fart into one unit and have it come through the register of another unit, as far as I can tell.
Those grates don't suck. The machine on the roof or the side of the building sucks and pushes it out the grate.
Well, there's theoretically an inlet that's in this guy's unit who's smoking, but it's not attached to the separate system that's above him.
It's not like two Folgers cans and a string. It's not A to B.
No, it's like if you were behind somebody in traffic and they had their air conditioning on and they blew their smoke into their dashboard. It was somehow
right into
coming
your
through.
Tailpipe or,
it's not how it works. But and it's also, over 100 Americans die of secondhand smoke every day.
Wow.
Now, the reason you need to think about this stuff is this is led by Barbara Ferrer of the whatever LA City Council, you know, health, whatever. She's lying. These are lies. And you go, all right, well, who cares? I mean, you quit smoking, you quit smoking. Like, it's all for the cause, right? But now you switch it over to COVID, and now you got the same fucking people lying, and it's not the black kid living upstairs anymore. It's your kids not going to school, or you staying locked in your house, or business closing down because they can't do outdoor dining. Now their lying does have some consequences. So get used to it. But they're in the lying department, and I always get these, and I always send them to Dr. Drew, and I go, you know what causes earaches and SIDS? And he just laughs maniacally as if a doctor. By the way, if there were over 100 Americans dying every day of secondhand smoke, you don't think some doctors would be aware of this? They don't even know how to categorize
Also, like Bryan said, I hope this wasn't listed in order of importance.
Yeah, because really
ear infections are not as bad as crib death.
It's all just, hey, people, we get to lie as long as it's for the cause.
Right.
But the problem is they're in charge of the cause, and they'll decide what that is. TJ Miller is calling from a gas station in upstate New York. Well, TJ?
Times are tough.
Hey, guys.
Hey, are you on a cell phone or a payphone?
I am on my cell phone. Can you imagine me being on a payphone? Yeah, I'm calling from 1993, Adam.
Well, you're at a gas station. That says payphone to me. I don't know. What are you doing in upstate New York?
So my father-in-law lives in... I was just getting my hard seltzer as I walked out here to talk to you guys. He lives in Sag Harbor, so kind of near the Hamptons, but not as douchey as the Hamptons. Mm-hmm. And so we were up there visiting him and, you know, just talking about crib death and smoking and the black kid upstairs and, you know, now COVID keeping basically the same thing you guys are talking about.
And you're with your wife?
Yeah, we're actually, I think that the car service that we use is trying to apologize to us because one of their drivers, who has now been fired, said some really inappropriate stuff to me on the way to the airport. And so they sent us a Sprinter van, which is like a party bus. Mm-hmm. But a party bus for me and Kate is amazing, but it's not really. It's pretty funny to be like, both of us are basically the same age. I'm 11 years older than her. Pretty funny to sort of get in a party bus with two cats on the way back to our place in Manhattan. And it's just us sort of silently sitting and on our phones. And the lights are changing from red to blue to green. And
there's a stripper
very
pole.
Low soundtrack of DaBaby. There is a stripper pole, but I'm the only one who's used it so far.
Right.
I do feel the same way. And you probably know it too. Like you go play casino and they put you up in the suite at the top and it's got the big sunken hot tub and it sits there empty your whole time. You're watching Sports Center laying on top of the comforter on top
Someone
of the bed.
Should be using this.
Somebody should be using this. So
That's exactly right. What are you going to do? Have a stripper come and just strip while you are in the tub alone, like 10 feet away?
Wait,
yeah,
what did
it's
the,
hilarious.
What did the driver say to you, though? So inappropriate.
He was trying to talk about some. He had looked. He said, "Oh, I didn't realize you were famous." And I was like, "Really? You didn't?" And he goes, "Yeah, I hadn't seen you in anything." And then I looked you up, and it said all the movies that you've been in. I've actually seen a couple of those movies. And I was like, yeah, a lot of people have seen a couple of those movies. And then he said, and I read all this terrible stuff about you. And then he started just going into it.
Oh, boy.
And I said, why the fuck would I want to talk about that? Why are you doing that? He said, yeah. But then it said that you hit this guy. And I was like, all right, asshole, shut up. Don't talk. And luckily, we were arriving at the airport. And I just said, why do you think I would want to talk about negative stuff for my life? And he's kind of, you know, but actually on the way, here's the really inappropriate thing. On the way, he was driving me and he said, how did he bring it up? He was like, yeah, I mean, when they put you away for a couple of years, you know, then it's, you know, you can get in a fight. I was doing a lot of push-ups when I was in jail. And I was like, you were in jail? And he's like, yeah, for assault. You know what I mean? It's crazy. But anyway, I was trying to get big, man. And I was just like, why are you telling me all this? He's like, you know, you're a funny guy. You're in movies. And so I thought you want to hear about my experience, you know, in the, he called it something like The Pen, but it was not his 1950s.
Mm-hmm. And the Who's Gal.
And so, you know, it was from the beginning to the end, it was this very surreal, uncomfortable sort of conversation. So he got fired and they sent us a party bus. So that's where I am now.
That's outrageous, TJ. But I do have some questions about your past.
Funny. Sure. I was watching Curb Your Enthusiasm last night. And the whole storyline was about his driver and the car service, and he called into the car service, and it's really life imitating art.
Simpatico.
Over here. But he did know you. Like, I feel you got some range because you got the Deadpool series, and then you got the Yogi and Boo Boo. You know, and so
which I'm much more proud of, obviously. And, you know, I do. I have Gravity Falls, and then I have Office Christmas Party. So I've got people that come up to me after shows. I was talking to Kate about this last night. We were smoking. I said, you know, it's really fascinating to me because I had a family just a little while ago come up to me after the shows. And they said, oh, we love Office Christmas Party. And they said, you know, I like when you fucking do cocaine and Jason Bateman sucking that ice sculpture dick, you know? It's the guy, the father that's saying this. I'm like, it's fun. It's a fun movie. He's like, it's great. And both of our kids are autistic, and they really love Gravity Falls. And I just said to them, I go, this is the most beautiful interaction I've had at a meet and greet in a long, long time, because I'm hitting all four quadrants there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. R-rated comedy, right? Mm-hmm. Children's comedy, kind of, you know, it's something that's making autistic kids sort of soothed and feeling better, and then kind of latent homosexuality with an ice sculpture for the husband. So yeah. I think, you know, that's
for everybody.
I can hit all corners.
For those who don't know Gravity Falls, my kids watched it, it's one of those cartoons you can watch with your kids because it works on a few different levels. Mm-hmm. Smart, like well-written. It's no fucking Dora the Explorer. Like, Wubsy or Dora the Explorer, you're going to fucking eat a bullet 10 seconds into the opening. Gravity Falls is fucking funny. Like, it's well done. I don't know who does it. I don't know how that came about, but it's a funny show.
It was Alex Hirsch, and he's really great. And it's all kind of a mystery. It's very engaging. And Guillermo del Toro said that it was his favorite television series of all time.
Oh, shit.
And Alex Hirsch is just this really brilliant kid that Kate and I became really good friends with him and his girlfriend. And, it's just one of those shows where it was made for adults, and it just happened to be a cartoon that kids love. That was on the Disney Channel, you know?
It's been off for a little while, or are they still making them?
It was one of the great... I love shows like this. This is part of why I left Silicon Valley, because they were going to just go as long as they could. You know, they were going to beat that horse far beyond its own life. So, you know, I hate these... So Gravity Falls, he just did two seasons, and that's it.
Oh,
he did two kind of really long seasons, and then British television style said, that's it. And, you know, there's a petition to get it back on, and there all the stuff that usually happens, like with the show Community. Mm-hmm. But they didn't really understand that Disney didn't cancel it. It's that Alex Hirsch was sort of like, it's not going to get any better than this. It's just going to be difficult to keep it this high of standard. And I really like that. I mean, Adam, you've done that with radio. You know what I mean? You did it for a little while, and then you got out on top. And I think that that's great, man.
Well, maybe in the middle, but thanks. there is something creatively. I mean, look, let's not end up like Sherwood Schwartz, who's basically flogging a dead donkey of, how about the very Brady robot Gilligan's Island Christmas? I mean, wouldn't it be great if in, you know, 2003 we could reunite the middle-aged cast of the Brady Bunch and get them with a 77-year-old Bob Denver, and the skipper's dead, but we'll get a feel-alike for him, and then they can play robots, and I think Meadowlark and Curly's still alive. Like, those are ideas you shat out in 1969, you fucking retard. Move on.
Just fucking Weekend to Bernie style. Right. He's dead and gone, but we just embalmed him, and now he's our puppet string. Yeah, I mean, you know, that's what you don't want to do. And you also don't want to be a guy where people are maybe looking back at the show. Like, I didn't want to be the guy in Silicon Valley if they want 8 or 9 seasons or something that people are going, ugh, TJ looked really funny in the beginning. Now he just looks kind of bad and unhealthy. You know, I wanted that to sort of be that funny time from my work and then go on and do different stuff. I don't want to, you know, shoehorn this in, but I'm really excited about doing your series. It's coming up, The Unprepared. And I think it's going to be great. And that's one of the things that I'm doing right now is I'm doing stand-up and I'm shooting mini specials that are of me doing completely improvised stand-up off of just not even audience suggestion, but off of just they flash a name of a joke behind me, and then I have to improvise the bit right then and there. And then when it's done, they give me another, you know, joke title, and then I do another one. And, you know, I do about 12, 15 of those, and then we patch it together. And it's really fun. It used to be a television show in the United Kingdom on Sky, British Sky Television. And I did that, and it was really, really fun and successful. So I'm just sort of producing them on my own. But it's going to be exciting to go and do kind of see you sort of doing your thing at Brea December 15th.
Yeah, well,
and to be a part of that.
Just to give a plug to TJ, December 15th, Brea, early show, the 4 o'clock show. We'll do Truth Yeller there, and you can get tickets at adamcarolla.com. Also, TJ is going to be in Omaha, Nebraska at the Funny Bone. That'll be Thursday through Sunday. And then Fort Wayne, that's coming up. Summit City Comedy Club, December 9th through the 11th.
Fort Wayne got canceled. Oh. Fort Wayne got canceled. They're not ready.
They're not ready for really your funny breed of comedy?
It's a new club. They were going to have me kind of open it, which they didn't tell me until just a couple weeks ago. And then yesterday, they called my agent and they said, you know, the club's just not ready, and so we don't want to cancel it right before he comes. So we'd like to cancel it now because we don't think we can. And we said, well, why isn't it ready? And they said, you know, manager just quit. There's an issue with the liquor license, all this stuff. And I said, also, we because of supply chain problems, we don't have stall walls in any of the bathrooms.
Oh.
So I thought that was pretty funny that you would have to, not to be crude, but you're just taking a shit next to a guy and kind of going, well, so what did you think of the show? Pretty good so far. I like the first guy. You want to hold hands while we get through this next bit? We're not going to be doing that, but I'm going to Virginia Beach after that, and then that's it for my year.
I was thinking about it the other day for some reason. It was this really simple bit. Jimmy Kimmel used to do bathroom interviews. He did them on The Man Show, but he also did them on K-Rock. And he would just sit in a stall and wait for somebody else to occupy the next stall. And he'd wait till the person
got the pants down,
comfortable, and sat down.
Got comfortable.
And then at some point, the thing that was always really funny about it is it would always start with the same question. Jimmy just go, how's it going? And there'd be a long pause every time. And of course, it got to him sliding pizza. You know, you're hungry, you're going to be here for a while. And they'd start talking about everything. But I don't know why the very simple, how's it going, always cracked me up. And you'd have to wait. Like, you have to wait like 30 seconds to hear the guy with his belt and his pants and everything. Right. And then there'd always be a long pause after he said, how's it going? But the person would always answer.
And this is the dawn of cell phones. So it's totally plausible that he was just talking. Like, the guy would Bluetooth. Be like, that fucking guy's talking to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, today, it'd be like, he's talking to his wife or whatever.
It's funny. We didn't, although that did, it did. I haven't told you guys this story in a long time. But when I was doing Dancing with the Stars, at some point during like the, I don't know, Sunday rehearsal or whatever, the place wasn't filled. There's a little bathroom that's kind of off the stage that the guys, the crew uses more so, but it's right there. So I just like slipped away. And there was a guy standing at the, urinal. Oh no, there was a guy in the toilet, in the stall, the door closed. And right as I walked in, he just went, how's it going? Oh. And I went, going good. And he didn't say anything, you know. And I'm standing at the urinal, which is right up against the stall. And there's a pause. And I was like, not too shabby getting paid to take a shit, huh? And he goes, I'm on the phone.
Excuse you.
There should be a no cell phone in bathroom policy,
well,
right?
Yeah.
Gets confusing and uncomfortable.
I think the weirdest thing, and by the way, of course, Adam, you said that. Not too shabby. You're even using alliteration there. Not too shabby getting paid to take a shit.
That's right.
But I think the weirdest is when somebody gets on. I've always wanted to do this. When somebody puts it on speaker and is just talking and you're hearing the entire conversation while you're in the stall next to them. Yes. I've always wanted to set up that call, you know, and have the other person in on it. And me sort of saying, well, I don't know. I mean, where can you take this? The body. It's like, I don't know, man. I mean, I said, well, just wait and see if she's really dead or if, you know, if she's just knocked out. I think that would be amazing. Imagine just being next to someone and they're talking about a possible murder or something like that. But you're right that now it's not that weird for people just to apparently talk to themselves.
Well, that's why Austin Powers was way ahead of his time. That's one of the best scenes ever in a comedy when he's fighting the guy in the toilet and screaming, who does number two work for? And Tom Arnold's in the next stall. Yeah, you tell him, buddy.
I forgot about that.
That's so great.
All right, TJ, I will give you and us a plug. Brea, December 15th, we'll do the early show at 4 o'clock with TJ Miller. And then we'll do a late, I think it's a 7:30 show with Patrick Warburton. We'll do that as well. TJ's got shows, Omaha and then Virginia Beach. Is that where you figured out?
Yes, that's what's going down next. And I'm so excited to be with you on the 4 o'clock because, first of all, I like to eat early. And second of all, I think this is really my wheelhouse is improvising stand-up. And I just improvise a lot in my stand-up. And I've seen a couple of clips of you with Leno and with Rob Riggle. And it's an awesome idea. And it's kind of your wheelhouse also. I mean, you're improvising every day on the show. But it's really cool because it's us doing what we do together and you doing your thing. But in, you know, a really real stand-up live audience environment. So I think it's going to be perfect. I've been looking forward to it for at least a day and a half, maybe less.
Well, right back at you, TJ. I look forward to seeing you on the 15th, my brother.
It's good. Thank you guys so much. Good to hear from each and every one of you.
The great TJ Miller, everybody. All right. You have the man show clip? Wow. All right. Is this bathroom interviews?
Yes.
Before, I spent a great deal of time in the bathroom, and not just at home. Recently, I spent several hours in the men's room of a local mall.
Trying to get a George Michael autograph.
Nothing like that. I was working because men are a lot more willing to chat when they can't move because their pants are down. So join me now, huddled with a hidden camera in a men's room stall, for these revealing bathroom interviews.
Allbrook Mall. We got guys to sign off on this. I'll never know. Jimmy's already placed. Toilets are only 20 inches apart.
How's it going in there? Hey, fella, how's it going? Doing pretty good.
Hey, fella.
What'd you have for lunch?
I haven't had lunch.
May I recommend the rotisserie chicken?
Oh, my God.
That's what I got going right now.
This is the floor view of the shins and shoes.
How's it going? Think you can guess my name?
Not really.
I'll give you five guesses.
John.
John? No, that's one.
Josh.
Josh? No, it's not Josh.
Bill.
Nope, not Bill. Not Bill, that's three, you got two left.
James?
I'm sorry, what was that?
James.
James is absolutely right.
I'm
positive. People call me Jimmy, but my name is James. That's astounding that
this guy wants out.
Yeah. He's moving. He's shifting.
And to congratulate you, please enjoy this plate of brownies.
Find the brownies under the stall.
Would you like
some? Thanks.
You've got a gift, my friend.
Oh my God.
Go forth and share it with the world.
Jesus Christ. Forgot about that bit.
I hated that.
Make you uncomfortable?
Yes. I mean, can you imagine that happening to you?
I don't know. It makes me laugh. I don't know why. I'm just, what'd you have for lunch?
No, it's great. I'm just saying, like, as a viewer, it's great. Can you imagine being the guy? And like you said, somebody said, yo, okay, I'll let you guys do this on the show.
We had to clear it with the mall.
Set up a camera?
Did like we had to talk to the guys who ran the mall and go,
yeah.
"Hey,
we'd like to
set up some cameras in your bathroom over here."
You know, nothing big ask.
Oh my God!
It was a different time.
It really was.
All right, we'll do some trending topics in a second. First, I'll tell you about Tommy John. Not too late to get comfy, thanks to Tommy John's extended Cyber Monday sale. Celebrate softness season with Tommy John underwear, loungewear, and pajamas. Shop their extended Cyber Monday sale right now and give the gift of comfort to everyone on your list, including yourself. Over 16 million pairs sold. Giving the gift of Tommy John has become a holiday tradition for families across the country. Once you go with the Tommy John, you will not go back. They don't have customers. They have fanatics. I've been telling you this for years. The Tommy John underwear will not leave the house without them. And then the pajamas are great. The loungewear is great. The undershirts stay tucked in. The bras, everything. It's the best pair you'll ever wear. It's free. Guarantee, right?
That's right.
Sorry, Dawson.
During Tommy John's extended Cyber Monday sale, get 20% off site-wide plus free shipping at TommyJohn.com/Adam. Get 20% off plus free shipping for a limited time only at TommyJohn.com/Adam. Go right now to TommyJohn.com/Adam. See site for details.
All right, we'll take a quick break. Loxamon will come in here. We'll do some trending topics right after this.
It's time to check Adam's voicemail.
Ace Man, Tommy from New Hampshire. I have an addendum I'd like to add to the yummy test. Although it's not a food item, I think it's very relevant that you point out how many razor blades are on your shaving razor. When I was a younger man, I was very attracted to the marketing campaigns for the 5-bladed Gillette, but now, as an older man, I use the single-edge razor. Get it on.
You can leave us a message at 888-634-1744.
I'm old enough to remember the twin blade being a big break. I wasn't shaving, but I remember the commercials. The twin blade, oof. Like this notion. There's a single blade for 900 years, right. And then they put a second blade, and that was a big deal. They run commercials.
Where it's the first one lifts up the hair, the second one cuts
that's
it.
That's right. Right. Now there's six. I'm a snob, by the way. You try the disposable twin bladers now. Right. It's like someone's just tugging on your face.
Yeah.
All right, Maxipati, got Hello. Some trending topics?
Sure do.
Your producing skills are lame. Makes fun of how your shows. Okay. You seem to only make things worse when you explain to him how Twitter works.
All right, so there are two guys kind of under attack right now in the Twitterverse.
Mm-hmm.
Let's kick it off with Seth Rogen.
Mm.
I love Seth Rogen. He's been on the show a few times.
What happened?
Yeah, Caitlin's taking pictures with Seth Rogen, like when he was in here, and he I guess he came in when Caitlin worked at the Coffee Bean.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God, that's Caitlin!
I didn't know it was possible for Caitlin to look younger
and prettier.
Yeah,
look at that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway, Seth.
She's gorgeous.
She's a vision.
I love that picture. So Seth was under attack over the weekend. Because so what happened was a YouTuber named Casey Neistat tweeted last week, "So our cars got robbed this morning, but tremendous appreciation and gratitude to the hardworking officers at the LAPD who not only arrested the motherfucker, but they got all of our stolen goods back." And everybody just talking about like, oh, man, yeah, that's, you know, terrible.
Hold on. How did that happen?
That's rare.
Yeah.
Did they say there was
a special needs child in the backseat?
Like, do you think the cop had one of his computers in the car, too? Like, I feel like that's the only motivation.
I'm thinking, okay, you know, like one explanation will snap things into focus. I'm thinking outskirts of LA, like Woodland Hills or someplace where the cops are a little less encumbered.
Doesn't feel, Hollywood to me.
No,
but anyway.
I know, and it's sad that that's our response to when cops do that. Like, how?
Yeah.
How in the world?
Northridge.
What happened? Yeah. Well, anyway, people were kind of responding how all these smash and grabs are going now, reaching Southern California from like the Bay Area where it's very prominent. And then Seth decided to chime in because everyone's talking about, living in LA and now people are just getting their cars broken into. And Seth replies, "Dude, I've lived here for over 20 years. You're nuts. It's lovely here. Don't leave anything valuable in your car. It's called living in a big city."
Right. But here's where I was thinking about this the other day. It's scary territory. You leave your backpack on your driver's seat. You got to expect to get your window kicked in. Yeah, it's like we're getting into the territory of you leave your picnic basket out and the bears are going to take it. Right. It's your fault for taking food to the wilderness. It's like, are we thinking of these people as animals now?
Yeah.
Like, because we've now shifted the onus from the perp to the hiker, to the camper. Very fucking dangerous. There's this fucked up reverse engineering that's going on right now, which is if the math scores are too low, then we get rid of the math test, or we can jigger the way we interpret the math test. I mean, that's not how you run a society.
Right.
It can't be our fault for having shit that we own that we leave in our car.
Stuff's not wrong. You should expect to have stuff stolen, but that's a sad commentary.
Yeah. Well, also, you sounded like one of the speakers at Take Back the Night.
That's right.
Yeah. Same thing.
That's right. Where's my rape whistle?
That's right.
Well, and Seth added on to his tweet.
Mm-mm.
"Look, you can be mad, but I guess I don't personally view my car as an extension of myself. And I've never really felt violated any of the 15 or so times my car was broken into."
Well, that's a rich guy.
Yeah.
It's a lot, but by the way, is it 15 or so? Like, I'd put bars over the fucking windows when we got to number 9.
Yeah, I wouldn't still live here if it was
15.
But
I
didn't know all that.
Maybe a little hyperbole. But here's also the thing, and I don't think people really realize this. Like, when I worked construction, I drove a Zuzu Trooper. I parked across the street from this gym I was working at, and they stole my tools. When you're poor, it fucks your shit up royally.
Oh, yeah.
When you have tools or a computer or an instrument or something like that, and you're fucking poor, your world is rocked, like big time. When you have money and they steal a fucking jigsaw or laptop or whatever.
Annoying.
Yeah, it's sort of the difference between what a $79 parking ticket is to when you're strapped to when you're Seth Rogen, you get a $79. You can fucking laugh it off. Yeah. I can just keep walking.
I had a panic attack trying to run to my car so I wouldn't get a parking ticket.
Right.
Like, it was super embarrassing because we would park when I worked in Pasadena. We would just park on the street, and I saw the guy pulling up to my car, and I just sprinted because, and I literally had a panic attack.
In LA,
it was so sad.
That's a day's pay.
If your car is parked like on street cleaning side, you're like, oh my God, I got to get up at 8 in the morning and move. Mm-hmm. And nowadays, like, if it's street cleaning, great, someplace for me to park.
Right.
It's going to cost $50, or whatever.
Yeah, so this started a Twitter war.
Yeah, well, it just, so people started like spelling Seth Rogen's name as Joe Rogan's last name, like Seth Rogen, and just comparing them to, and now they're putting them both into the pot. Like, man, both these guys suck. So it's just...
Joe Rogan's like, what did I do?
Everyone just really upset that's how Seth would respond.
Well, I know Joe got his horse broken into the other day. You don't leave valuables in your saddlebag. Seth says that's on Joe.
Yeah, you don't consider your horse an extension of
yourself.
You're
in a big city. Come on.
It's not an extension of yourself when you have money and you're leasing a car and you're fully insured and all that kind of shit. When you're poor and you get your wing punched in and you have to repair it with foil and live with it, like when I'm driving my pickup truck and they pulled out my ignition, you know, you couldn't, like when you're poor, you can't go to the dealer for any parts because the dealer's crazy markup. That's stadium prices for beer.
Yep.
You know what I mean? You have to go.
That's airport.
You
got to
know a guy.
You got to go to Costco and you got to drink out in the parking lot. And so I would go, you'd go to Pick Apart in Sun Valley and you pull some alternator off some other Nissan truck that didn't have any miles on it or whatever. It was always somebody died in this car. You'd see the driver's side door just caved in, a little blood on the steering wheel. And you'd be like, all right, but he would have wanted me to have his alternator. So you'd have to go to like Pep Boys and get rebuilt shit, or you'd have to go to Pick Apart and pull something off. Like you'd have to show up with your own tools, you know, and the guy would let you go back there. You'd find your car, the one that was equivalent to yours, and like pull a water pump or something off it.
My uncle, who loved cars and recommended the Trico Blades, his dream was to spend all day at Pick Apart. He loved it.
He was quite a conversationalist as well.
If I needed anything on my car, he's like, I'll get that for you. I'll be back in 2 days.
My dad was this. Oh, no, wait. So then if you had to get something from the dealer, now the whole thing about the ignition is that was like a dealer item. You couldn't go to Pep Boys and find that. It was a dealer item, and it was like $239, which I definitely didn't have. So I just start my car with a screwdriver. You could just get a flathead screwdriver, poke it in, and turn it like you're in a heist movie or something. And it worked. But when you're fucking poor, that car is an extension of you. And when they fuck it up, it fucks you up.
Well, a lot more people seem to agree with you, Adam, especially on Twitter over the weekend. And this speaking of smash and grabs and things like that, this video has been making the round again. It's from May of last year, but it's been getting a lot more views like today and yesterday. And so looters getting looted by other looters.
Yeah, it's
on, man.
Shot of someone trying to leave with some stuff and a bunch of other looters converging on them. Yeah. Well, why go all the way into the store if you can just sort of loot out in the parking lot?
Well, it's like you say, criminals are lazy, and this is the bottom of the barrel. You are waiting for the robber to come out with the stuff he robbed so you can rob him.
Yeah, I guess we're going to have to start like watermarking everything or putting dye packs on everything over $100. Right. Or we're going to have to track this shit as it pops up on eBay and starts getting sold online and stuff like that. I mean, no one is, like I would say about my truck stereo that I painted brown, no one's stealing it to listen to music. They're stealing it to fence it and get drugs. So all the stuff that's being looted is pretty much getting pushed out, fenced somewhere, and sold.
Yeah.
I wonder now if it's a little more organized, and now they're having rings, you know?
Well, yeah, when 15 cars pull up in front of Macy's or whatever, you know?
Look at this. I got a video of this place called Prime.
It must be leaving the country now.
Because
I think the local looting was local looting before, but if you're going to be organized about it... I think this shit's got to get to Mexico or somewhere where you can safely get your money back for it. I feel the organization part always says, and it'd be kind of refreshing for us to bring contraband into Mexico. You know what I mean? Like, hey, we're bringing something back, right back at you.
Case of your own.
Yeah.
This is a shop in Oakland, a shoe and hat shop, and just watch like this. This is what a surveillance video of them getting looted. Look at
this.
It's a clown car. Exactly.
Yeah, and they
there's
just
what
got everything.
30 dudes.
They're still coming.
There's exactly, clown car.
It has the.
They're still coming.
It has that thing of when you see mice scurry.
Yes.
Like when they're leaving a sinking ship
they're
or something, just keep plowing in. I would.
There's at least 30 dudes.
Yeah.
Sadly, easily. I would think long and hard about what business I was running as it pertained to potential looting.
Yeah.
A lot now, of shoe stores in the Bay Area are getting hit.
Right. Would you open a shoe store in a very progressive blue place, like right in the middle with a DA that was kind of soft on whatever and a defund the police?
It's not
kind
a crime
thing, like,
if it's less than $1,000.
Yeah, I don't think I'd open a sneaker shop or a hat shop or something.
Yeah, it's something you have to think about now.
Well, and I don't want to profile, but let's see. Like you said, there's a sneaker shop. You think it's a lot of like middle-aged women, or you think it's a lot of just chicks at all, or
no,
dads,
all,
or what are we talking about here?
I think this is all dudes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Speaking of dads, I'm thinking about Christy's dad's power tool shop.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Thankfully, it's
bored that up.
A little off the beaten path, but it's probably a boulevard.
Which shop?
It goes all the way up to the valley.
Bought a palm nailer there in 1991, man.
The plaque is still there.
I know, I put it
the
up.
Dollar is
on
in a frame.
Date.
Other than your cars, have you guys ever been robbed in any way?
Thankfully, just car.
Yeah, me too.
A few times, unfortunately.
I was, when I was working on my first house in Hollywood Hills, somebody broke in, stole some tools, and took a shit in the bathtub.
That was Ray.
That part that, or Ray could have taken a shit in the bathtub on Friday afternoon before he knocked off, and then on Saturday they broke in.
This poor guy gets in trouble.
You will get your tools stolen. You always get your tools stolen. We got the Adam Carolla project. We got our tools stolen. You'll always get tools stolen,
yeah.
and it's a fucking backbreaker because getting items stolen in general is a bummer, but when your tools get stolen, you can't go to work.
Right.
You cannot show up Monday without tools. I don't know if people really know this, but carpenters have their own tools, need their own tools, and work with their own tools.
Yeah.
So when they swipe them, you're fucked. Well, I got my, I guess I've had a lot of tools stolen. I had tools stolen when I was working at Bodies in Motion, my Zuzu Trooper got busted into. I got tools stolen from the Adam Carolla project, but I had money by then, so I didn't care. I got tools stolen from the house when I was working on my first house in Hollywoodland. And I got famously my fucking Porter Cable door planer, my big ticket $400 item stolen from my fucking grandma's shed. The problem with being poor is it's the same with parking. I used to get parking tickets all the time because you can't afford to pay for the parking and you park down the street
and it
fucking whatever. You have money. You have a fucking garage and a clicker. Like you don't park on the street and you have a parking space at work and all that kind of stuff. When you're poor, you have to constantly try to maneuver around where you're going to park. And
well, dude, remember K-Rock in Burbank?
Yes.
It was that at a... The high rise surrounded by other high rises. There were, and across the street was the freight overpass. Nowhere to park.
Right.
I mean, you'd be a couple of spots on the street, but they'd be half the time. It'd be street cleaning.
And then you get shit broken into.
Parking.
Yeah, my Porter Cable door planer was stolen from my grandmother's house by a fucking homeless guy. She let in to rake leaves, and it had a beautiful metal silver case that it was in. And I had a door hanging job. And when you hang doors, you need a door planer. Do not let anyone fool you with, I'll get the circular saw and trim the side of it. That's bullshit. Bush League is DFG would say.
Yeah.
Do not, you fucking need a real door planer. You have to put a bevel on it because doors have a bevel on the strike side, the knob side. And if you're good, you put a bevel on the hinge side too so it doesn't pinch.
Mm.
You need a good door planer. And I was like, I'm poor shit, but I hang doors for a living and I need a good door planer. And I bought this $375. I mean, at the time, all the money in the world. And I lived in an apartment, so I didn't have any place to keep anything. Yeah. This is part of the poor person thing. And I kept it. My grandparents, they had like a shed garage thing or something, but it was inside the house. I mean, it was in the on the property. And she let some motherfucker rake leaves. And I went in there to get it because I had a door job. And I picked up the case, which was brand new, and I could feel how light it was. And I was like, oh
you know.
I started lifting. My arm went to the ceiling. I was like, fuck. And I opened it up, and I was like, fucking gone. And I was like, then you're mad. Like, did I lend it to a buddy? Did one of my buddies something? You start, and it starts dawning on you. And then my grandmother's like, well, I let Keyless Chuck in to rake some leaves.
When grandma's partially culpable, does she offer it all to, you know, to pitch in $50 for the next one?
Would a grandmother do that?
when this grandmother.
Of course. Oh, my grandmother?
The specific grandmother.
No fucking way. Not on your life. Like, I literally said to my grandmother, I was like, oh, man, like, what happened? What happened? Yeah. And she's like, Oh, I did have, there is a guy who just kind of wanders around, you know, drinking out of a bag. He wanted to, you know, he needed $3 or something. So I told him, come in and, you know, rake the leaves.
Yeah.
And,
a lot better than that day.
And so she was like, he must have stolen. He must have taken it.
Mystery solved.
Anyway,
goodbye.
He took it. And then I did what I've tried with my family on probably 26 times in my life where I went, wow, man, that's tough because, you know, I make my living with that. I got a job coming up where I'm swinging doors and, man, I can't do it without that tool. But I don't have enough money to go buy a new one. But how can I get the money if I don't have the tool? My grandma's like, yeah, well, shit happens, man.
Oh,
yeah.
Boy.
But I hearken back to the conversation with my mom about having warrants and the motorcycle and needing to pay off the warrants. And she's like, take Valley Heart. It runs parallel to Ventura Boulevard. They're fucking horrible people. I mean, that's fucking horrible. I couldn't have. First off, if Sonny had a tool that he used as an adult, I would break down in tears. I would weep openly, number one. And then number two, if I was responsible, basically, partially for letting the person in and getting himself, by the way, they had money, you know, they had the retirement and account and everything. And I was just fucking living fucking hand to mouth the whole time. She's like, she just looked at me and went, nah.
I think your grandmother and I are the full spectrum of boundaries. Because I need to be more like her, but not that much like her. And for her to just look at you and go, yeah, what are you going to do? I would dream to do that to someone when I felt like my boundaries were being infringed on, but not that far.
Compare that to my dad, who we went on a family trip. Well, this is, I remember summer of 2000. I brought, remember the CD book. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You don't want to travel with 1,000 jewel cases. You put all your CDs in the book and rented a car. I was in the back seat, you know, my brother and I in the back seat, put my CD book in the back pocket of the seat behind my dad driving, and got to the hotel, checked in, blah, blah, blah. Unbeknownst to us, he decided the car wasn't big enough and went to take it upon himself to return it the next morning before we woke up.
Uh-huh.
Come to find out, he's like, I returned the car. I'm like, did you take my CD booklet out? Your CD booklet was in there? Yes, it was, Dad. So, of course, called the airport car return place. Guess what? They hadn't found it. No one returned it.
But you heard Oasis in the background.
That's right. Walking out.
Damn it.
Yeah, exactly. That so I knew Muzak. It was up. And my dad, the honorable guy that he was, he goes, all right, listen, that's kind of on me. It's kind of on you. It's kind of on me. We'll go down to Rasputin Records in Berkeley, California, Dawson, and I'll buy your CDs used. You know what I mean? I'll buy you used copies, but it'll be good enough.
Yeah,
yours
well,
were used.
What? Exactly. My grandmother was a fucking witch because, and also, I wasn't like, hey, grandma, could I have, you know, $200 so I get some fentanyl-laced tablets or
just
something?
Keep you straight.
I was like, I'm trying to buy a fucking tool
that she had stolen.
That I needed to survive, that she aided in the stealing of, and she didn't even fucking blink. Like, I thought I was going to give her this hard luck pitch, and she was going to go, kind of like Brian's dad, like she was going to go, yeah, you know,
Let's see what we can do.
What's the tool cost? Okay, why don't you put me down for half? No such fucking luck whatsoever. Zero.
Impressive.
I know.
Sad.
I know. Sad. All right, let's bring it home. We got our guest
on the
line. All
right, thanks for listening, guys. Check out Water Cooler. Max Zapata. His real
name's Laxamana. All right, let me tell you about Lucy Slim Nicotine Pouch. We're all adults here. Some of us use nicotine to relax, focus, unwind after a long day. Lucy Nicotine, created to help nicotine users find a cleaner option and feel better about how they consume nicotine. Slim nicotine pouches contain pure synthetic with the same satisfaction nicotine users expect without any of the tobacco. Three strengths. You got 4, 8, and 12 milligrams in three exclusive delicious flavors, spearmint, mango, and cool cider. And Kaylin, I think you're trying these babies out, right?
That's right. They sent over some of the 8-milligram mango-flavored ones a little while ago, and I am enjoying them a lot. I've been using them ever since, actually.
It is Lucy Slim Nicotine Pouch. Am I right, Dawson?
It's 2021. Don't compromise when you're choosing your nicotine products. Go with the newest tobacco-free options from Lucy. Adam Carolla Show listeners, go to lucy.co and use promo code Adam to get 20% off your order of Lucy Slim Pouches or any other Lucy products. That's lucy.co and use promo code Adam at checkout. Also, warning, this product contains non-tobacco nicotine. Nicotine is an addictive chemical. Lucy.co, and be sure to use that promo code Adam.
So Jeremy Popoff is going to zoom in. He's the lead guitar player for Lit. Can we hear My Own Worst Enemy? Let's find that.
Classic.
I love that goddamn song so much.
It's got me through senior year in college. It's one of the CDs they were stolen.
Oh, Lit was one of your CDs?
That's right. It's a great song.
All right. We'll take a quick break. We'll talk to the man playing the guitar, Jeremy Popoff, right after this. That is Lit. The Jeremy Popoff has joined us, and the podcast, My Own Worst Enemy, the podcast, a four-part documentary podcast about that song. Good to see you again, Jeremy.
You too, brother. How are you?
I'm doing well. Where are you right now?
I'm at my house in Franklin, Tennessee.
Oh, nice. How is it out there? And how far is Franklin from Nashville?
We're about 30 minutes south of Nashville, and we love it out here. It's awesome.
When did you buy the house?
Well, when we first moved to Nashville, we were in Nashville proper, and then we bought this place in February. Because we wanted a little more privacy, a little more dirt, and so we came half hour out, and we're out here in the country and wildlife and horses and all that. It's pretty awesome.
You know, it's funny. When you live in L.A., your first thought is like, well, you can't leave L.A. You're in L.A. Everyone comes to you. But then you start thinking about these other places and a little more rural, and then everyone's like, well, how far out of town are you? And you go, half hour. Well, that's a lot of dirt road. But in L.A., it takes a half hour to get from Burbank to Van Nuys.
Yeah, it's so four and a half miles.
It's all paved. It's 4 miles, yeah. But it still takes half an hour. So what's the difference?
Yeah.
I mean, out here, 30 miles is 30 minutes, and half of it's country road and some of it's highway. But yeah, you're right. In California, I mean, we would have to leave. We're from Orange County, so we would have to, you know, go play a show somewhere, fly on LAX and get, you know, we'd have to leave the house at 4 a.m. for an 8 o'clock flight, you know, and out here, like I wait for someone to land and then I leave the house to go pick them up at the airport, you know?
And and I guess on that dirt road, you could hit a deer, but we hit homeless people. So what's really the difference? You know, at least the deer's family doesn't sue you. I know there's a viral video that's going around, 14 million views in less than 24 hours. You want to kind of set that one up? Because I'd like to check that out.
Yeah, I mean, we were downtown doing some stuff with Adley Stump. And we actually appeared on her YouTube show that's all about her getting married, and the internet picks her wedding and picks all the details out. And we were one of the bands that surprised her and auditioned to be the wedding band. But anyways, we were doing some stuff down there, and it happens regularly. I mean, we don't hang out on Broadway all the time, but if we go out there to meet some friends or if we're showing people around town, and it's inevitable that we hear a cover band playing My Own Worst Enemy out of one of the honky tonks on Broadway. And so we've gotten up several times and jammed with house bands and cover bands and things. And this one just happened to get captured when we had some cameras around and some people around. And it was, it's a pretty incredible. I've so never had anything go viral.
They're doing an acoustic version, which sounds good.
Yeah.
And you guys just happen upon it.
Slowly recognizing you. Everyone but the singer.
Yeah, because his back is still sort of to you guys.
You guys give everyone the shush to the audience, which is great.
Now, I think some people think this is cooked because it seems too good to be true. But you're saying it's not.
Well, we were filming a couple other things. So we actually had a couple people, you know, that were around us that were in that. I mean, that's why there's a couple different angles, you know. But the dude was really playing. He really played that song. And we really went up and played with him. And those were all just spectators that were hanging out. So, let's just say it was, I guess, half cooked. Once we realized we were going to do it, we were being encouraged to do it.
But you know how you can tell the performer had no idea? He didn't do some over the top, like he was trying his best to stay cool. He was trying to just not react and play the song and like be, you know, look cool.
And some people hit me up, like a couple of my friends, and they were like, oh, there was just a guitar there waiting. And it was like, yeah, dude, it's Broadway. There's guitars everywhere. There's musicians everywhere. People get up and jam all the time. And
no good deed goes unpunished.
Yeah, well, I mean, like you said, it was some ridiculous amount of millions of people saw it in less than a day. And it's wild when something like that goes viral because you get recognized and people... The guy working the counter at the gas station, you know, is like, hey, it's a weird, when something goes viral, it's like people's grandmas are watching it and you know, your veterinarian's watching it and it's a whole different deal. It's pretty mind boggling.
So let's talk about the podcast, and also I'll make an announcement, which is Lit's going to play the Carolla Drinks Family BBQ.
Nice.
That'll be Saturday. Yeah.
Oh, nothing.
June 2022. Yeah.
Nice.
That's going to be so great.
Now, I got to tell you, Offspring's a tough act to follow because they were super fun last year, or this year, I guess. Mm-hmm. Got the ukulele out, played all their... hits, but I know that Lit's going to be every bit as good as the Offspring was. Offspring's on the podcast. Yeah, on your podcast. Sorry.
Yeah. Noodles is on there. It talks to a lot of our peers, musical peers, industry people, soundtrack people. It musicologists, a professor from Berkeley's on there, and they really try to. We didn't have a whole lot to do with it. I mean, it wasn't our idea. We were approached about it, and we're very much just sort of guests on it like the other guests. And it was a trip to hear something that we did, such an innocent time, and we really didn't know what we were doing. And to have real professionals sort of dissect it like we're some sort of geniuses.
Yeah. Well, let's go back to when that song hit and blew up. What was Lit doing just before it? And how did it all come together?
Well, we were a pretty popular band in Orange County, California. We were playing, selling out clubs, and we had a lot of record companies checking us out and turning us down and passing on us. And we were just in this real kind of creative mode where wrote all those songs from A Place in the Sun were all coming about at that time. And it was just a song that kind of happened by accident. And it just took on a life of its own. It was lightning in a bottle. We had no idea that anything, I mean, you couldn't really ever predict something like that, you know, and especially something that's lasted two decades and still gets played as much as it does.
Was K-Rock the first, what are we talking about? 2000, 2001? What year are we talking?
K-Rock in LA added it in January of 99. Oh, wow. And it wasn't supposed to come out till like March. we thought we were going to have a couple months to like spend our record company advance and like party with our friends and stuff. And they added it and a couple other big stations added it. And then we left home and didn't come back for 2 years.
So once K-Rock added it, because I remember I was at K-Rock in 99. Bryan was...
I was listening. You were... I was listening to K-Rock. I was a junior in college, and that song was everywhere.
And
a huge hit.
Yeah, and so I was there and then was back. I don't know. And it's a, I don't know if we wish or long for these times or not. Mm. K-Rock could make you a star. You know, it used to be you'd go on Top of the Pops in England, or you'd get Dick Clark or something. You know, there were like some handful of tastemakers out there. You'd go out, you do stand-up comedy. You go out and do a set on Carson. And the next day, your entire world would change when Johnny signaled you over to the desk. You know what I mean? Those days are just a bygone era. Now, sometimes stuff goes viral, like you guys playing and walking into that acoustic set. But I mean, it's not what it was. It used to be K-Rock gives you spins, X amount of spins an hour or a day. And the next thing you know, your world blows up and you're in Europe touring, or you tell me.
Yeah, no, it really was like that. There were right out of the gate, there was a handful of influential stations. Of course, K-Rock was our hometown station and probably the toughest station in the country at the time to get added to. And even if you heard your song on it, you know, they had the, like the locals only show. And then they would have like these other things where, you know, they would play it once and pin you up against another song or whatever. And I think the reality of them hearing it on a new music commercial and then the reality of them playing it, like you said, like every hour on the hour kind of thing, that was a life-changing, because it was, wasn't part of some specialty show. It was like for real getting played all the time in LA and in Orange County. So, yeah. And then we left and honestly just never came home.
And nationally and internationally, obviously it's a great song and it's a huge hit, but I remember MTV was still a big deal back then. It had a really popular video. It was kind of Lebowski-esque. It said a bowling alley, very kitschy, and it had a big impact, big footprint on MTV.
Yeah, it was very ironic. Mm-hmm. It was perfect for the time.
Yeah, we kind of grew up in that era of funny videos that were lighthearted, like the, you know, the Twisted Sister videos, mm-hmm. and the
Beastie the Boys and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And we were also David Lee Roth, you know, that kind of videos.
Right, and we were probably influenced in the 90s just as much by movies and, you know, Quentin Tarantino movies and gangster movies and we were into that stuff too. And so we wanted to make videos that were a little bit cinematic and interesting. So, which we just did a new one for our new song called Yeah, Yeah, Yeah. And it's kind of a throwback to the old school lit videos that we used to have a blast doing.
So who'd you go out with, or did someone go out with you? Like when it came time to hit the road, I'm always interested in talking to bands on who opened for you or who'd you open for. It's always very interesting bedfellows a lot of the time.
Yeah. Offspring was the first big band to kind of offer us a world tour. They took us around the United States and Europe.
Was Dexter flying the plane, or did he let the pros handle
it? Oh, yeah. He was flying himself everywhere. We got to fly with him one time. He invited us to fly with him. We were in Canada going from one city to another, and I think there was five of us on his plane. And he's super smart guy. Obviously you know him, but he's just ultra intelligent guy. And he's reading the books and he's calling out the codes and the numbers and whatever. I don't speak pilot, but he's doing all the stuff you're supposed to do. And then the plane takes off and he's in the middle of his spiel to the co-pilot and to the tower. And then he turns back and he's like, dudes, check it out. We're going through the clouds. And I just remember going, holy shit, he's driving.
Yeah.
You're not supposed to really be all that. You're just not supposed to give a shit about clouds when you're the pilot. But yeah, they were awesome to us. That was our first taste of amphitheaters and arenas, and No Doubt, same thing, took us out. No Doubt took us out for like 3 months. Ton of festivals. We did the Warp Tour. We did a Kid Rock tour. And then when we did our headlining stuff, a lot of bands, like we took Good Charlotte out before anybody knew who they were. We heard there were these young kids on the East Coast that were doing well and that had, you know, some stuff happening. And so we took them out for like a week, and then they parlayed that into a record deal and a management deal and all that other stuff. So it was a trip. There's a real, cause we're such big fans of those bands that, you know, that we got to open for. And then the bands that were on these big radio festivals. I mean, you remember that time of 99, 2000, I mean, the bands that were on the circuit with us doing all these big, you know, like Weenie Roast and, mm-hmm. and, all those big shows. I mean, it was Chili Peppers and Hole and Stone Temple Pilots and, you know, Eminem. And I mean, it was a lot of really huge bands and artists that we were all of a sudden hanging out backstage with and playing shows with. It was crazy.
Yeah. I'm a little out of the scene now, but I feel like, according to my 15-year-old daughter, everything seems to be sort of rap related mm-hmm. now. I mean, there's definitely some rock out there, but I don't feel like I'm hearing, there was a definite genre. The bands were great live. You knew all the songs. They could all pull it off.
Right.
With maybe the exception of Third Eye Blind on occasion, but they could, and it was great. And you just go to the show and each band, I mean, the Weenie Roast, Acoustic Christmas. I mean, it was halcyon days. Yes, Brian.
I was going to say, I started screening calls at K-Rock in like, '01, right? For a couple of 2-3 years after that. And obviously I can't imagine Jeremy would talk shit about a lot of bands, but that sort of began an era of some sort of rap influences coming into rock music. There were some, forget about the rap itself, but there were some very bands that haven't stood the test of time, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? And there was a heavy rap influence coming into rock music, which, good or bad, it's up to you. But K-Rock got a lot of criticism, I know, because I screened the calls. The kids hated it. Some of them did. They were influencing or infusing a lot of rap into rock music.
Yeah, it feels like there's pop now, which... Yeah. Feels to me more like the hot chick singing. What's her name? Taylor Swift or whatever.
Yeah, sure.
Like it's like a lot of pop chick stuff, yeah. And then there's like a lot of rap
stuff.
Like
Drake, The Weeknd.
Yeah, but it's, I don't know.
Yeah,
maybe I'm old.
Well, I think we're all getting old because I think we're missing. I think you're right. I think we're missing that sound. I was going to ask when you mentioned No Doubt, of course, because they're Orange County too. I was wondering if your paths crossed in Orange County before a lot of the fame and, you know, everything took off for both of you.
Well, it's funny. We're both bands are from Anaheim, and Adrian and I actually went to high school together, but we didn't know each other in high school. I was like the long haired.
He's a lead guitar.
He's the drummer.
Oh, the drummer, Adrian, right. Young. The one who's always naked, yeah. Right? Yeah. That's right.
But we grew up, he's a couple years older than me. And so, but we did run in a similar circle of buddies back then. But music wise, Orange County wasn't much of a scene. I mean, as many huge acts that came out in like from the mid to late 90s, none of us were really pals coming up the ranks. So there was really there wasn't like one street where there was like four clubs where everybody played all the time and hung out afterwards at so-and-so's apartment. It was very, you know,
isolating.
One band was in Irvine and one band was in La Mirada and another band was in, you know, and everyone was spread out. It wasn't until we were really playing in the big leagues that we all met and became friends with each other.
Orange County doesn't get its due because we all know the Seattle sound and we all have this region kind of stuff, but Orange County not known, but so many big bands.
I feel like that was the place for music to come out of in the late 90s.
It was, but it doesn't get the label.
Right. That Orange County sound.
Yeah.
Like it did with all the
Seattle bands.
Seattle stuff and the grunge stuff. Yeah. It got that label. But I think, Sublime was probably, I don't know if they're Orange County, they're in that region in there. Even, I think if you look up where we're going into a little different genre, but Black Eyed Peas, Fergie, is from that region as well.
I can't believe it took me this long to put two and two together. I apologize, but Jeremy, I just realized, I had to look it up just to confirm it. You guys were part of Woodstock 99, yes, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Now, the documentary came out a few months ago, and I saw it, and it was great. It was really powerful. But talk about your experience with just the craziness, and did you see the documentary? Do you think it was accurate?
The best part of the documentary was the intro, because our song was playing for like two minutes and 15 seconds. It got dark real quick. I don't know. We played day one, and for us, it was a real big thrill because we had been gone for 6 months without touching base at home at all. And this was before FaceTime and before, any social media. So this was going to be the first chance for our family and friends to go on pay-per-view and actually see what we've been doing for the last 6 months out there. So it was a real special day for us and a huge honor. And then, but we were, Offspring played that day too. We were out with them. So when all the hell broke loose a couple of days later, we were already two shows in two states away.
Yeah, you timed it well.
Yeah, for us, it was a great experience. I mean, we loved it and we had a blast, and it was unfortunate the way it went down, you know, and I thought that the movie just really, the documentary just really focused on just like, they're really mad at Limp Bizkit.
Indeed. Well, what happened? I didn't see the doc. I do remember.
Okay, so the short version of that, the festival descended into chaos, and there were fires and rapes and general hysteria. But the 2-hour documentary, and Jeremy can talk to this too, is it talks a lot about, you're going to love this, toxic masculinity. They booked it with a certain flavor of band, Limp Bizkit, Kid Rock, who's the other one that they really focused on. Some very angry acts, you know what I mean? You got the crowd very riled up. Like, they juxtaposed them against Jewel and Alanis Morissette. And, you know, it was a volatile mix of idiots.
Sublime, by the way, Long Beach, which I kind of knew. But it's still, I'm sure everyone in Seattle, the Seattle sound, and grew up under the Space Needle.
No.
Someone was 12 miles out.
And
you know?
There's Social Distortion, Real Big Fish, Avenged Sevenfold.
Probably a Save Ferris
Sublime,
in there.
Right.
Yeah, it's a lot of bands coming from there. Jeremy, hang with us. Oh, where do we find that doc, by the way? I want to see
it. I think it's on Hulu. Does that sound right? Chris can look it up. Oh, HBO Max or Hulu. One of the two.
Chris will find it.
HBO Max.
There you go.
I know, sadly.
Bill Simmons produced.
Oh, yeah.
It was a part of music, you know, 30 for 30, basically.
Well, I'm going to definitely see that. I'm reading here that your first band, the lead singer, was killed in the Great White Fire from 03.
Oh, shit.
I didn't know that. Can you tell us about that?
Who you talking to me?
Yeah, or maybe not. Maybe Chris. Chris put it up on my screen, but if it doesn't sound familiar,
we'd love to be wrong because that sounds horrible.
Yeah, that's terrible. That's not a story about us, thank God. But
Jeremy's first band, the singer,
his name was Derek Johnson.
Oh shit! Okay.
Oh boy.
Recovered memory.
I put a band together with a couple of dudes that I found in the recycler, the classified ads, when I was 15 years old. And there was a kid named Derek who I forgot. I didn't even realize that until you just mentioned that. And now it kind of rings a bell. But that's crazy. That was weird. One of my very first, you know, just put an ad in the recycler like, Orange County metal guitar player seeks other like-minded, you know.
Gotta have the right look and the right attitude. Yeah, people. Yeah. We were
must have transportation.
Dad must have transportation. We're just talking about old car parts and all that kind of stuff. That's what you do. You get the recycler. It would come out Thursday morning. You had to get it early because the stuff would be gone if you needed something from the recycler. And you just open it up and you start circling stuff and calling and. you know, if you waited till Thursday night, the stuff would be gone, or the used truck you try to pick up, or whatever it is. God.
Man, if you had buy nothing back in your day, you'd live like a king. You know how much shit I give away on a daily basis?
I also wonder, like, how did we function as well as we functioned in that bizarre analog world? Like, I was thinking to myself, like, what the fuck? Without Waze, the app, like all the places I'm going.
Turn to page 172. You're on page 8.
Your Thomas Guide.
Goddamn Thomas Guide.
Oh, yeah. I mean, when I used to install closets, we were in Burbank and we'd be installing shit in Redondo Beach or something, and they'd Xerox the page from the Thomas Guide. And it was how many billions of gallons of fuel was. Wait, remember you talk about someone? I was thinking about this the other day. Like, you tell someone to go to the party, you know, and you go, all right, 134 off Sepulveda. Turn right, and then make a jog right to La Mesa. Not La Mesa Street, La Mesa Avenue, and there's a La Mesa Canyon, a La Mesa Way, but make sure you get La Mesa. But it's
alley.
A jog.
Go past that.
It's not a hard right. Mm-hmm. If you pass a 7-Eleven, you've gone too far. Come back to Gentry. Gentry will take you to Hartsook. Hartsook goes right to Houston Street. Houston is kind of a cul-de-sac. And it's like, and you just be writing it down on a cocktail napkin.
It'll say no outlet. Ignore that.
Right.
And then when MapQuest and SigAlert.com came out, that was the height of technology.
How the fuck did anyone find their way anywhere? All right, Jeremy, hang out with us. We'll do the news in a second. First, I'll tell you about Masterworks.io. Man, the last month, it's crazy out there. Pete Davidson's hooking up with Kim Kardashian. Zuckerberg's trying to create a real-life matrix. Elon Musk sold Tesla stock to Twitter because they are from Twitter because Twitter told them so. It's crazy out there. Chaos keeps things interesting. But when it comes to finances, you need to... hold on, let me try it again, Chris. When it comes to finances, you don't need to take big risks to get big rewards. There's a dependable investment billionaires have used to grow wealth for generations. It's an asset class whose global value will explode by $1 trillion in under 5 years. It's art. This is how rich people get richer. They invest in art. Masterworks. .io has revolutionized the lucrative art market by making multi-million dollar paintings investable like company stocks. This is the new thing. You can get in on some of this and do it like the rich guys do it, but at an affordable price. It's Masterworks.io, right, Dawson?
People have already invested over $300 million with Masterworks. Demand for this popular platform has never been higher, but you can skip their waitlist and get access today by going to Masterworks.io/Adam Carolla. That's Masterworks.io/Adam Carolla. See important disclosures at Masterworks.io/disclaimer.
All right, take a quick break. Jeremy's going to come back and join us for the news right after this.
Well, since we got a rock guy here today, let's start with something fun. I don't know if you guys have ever seen this, but Dave Grohl has returned with his producer, Greg Kurstin, to begin another installment of the Hanukkah Sessions. Mm. They did this last year, too. It's Live for Live Music, or Live for Live, reports that the first video in the series of 8 covers, of course, because Hanukkah, arrived on Sunday. And apparently the thing that makes it the Hanukkah Sessions, besides doing it one night for each night of Hanukkah, is the song they're doing. One of the members of the band comes from a Jewish background.
Is Dave himself Jewish?
He's not.
Okay.
Can I say this? You know what this nation needs about now to heal it? A goofy Adam Sandler song.
Yeah, it
brought us together as a nation.
Like, Thanksgiving, Hanukkah.
You could count on it. Once a year, it'd be a goofy Adam Sandler song, and somehow people would forget about their partisan politics and their troubles, and they'd all come together.
You're absolutely right.
Someone has to say to Adam, like, listen, I don't know, you're doing Grown Ups 13 in Maui right now, fucking put it on hold.
Yeah.
As an American, we're appealing to you to heal this nation.
Not quite as silly, but he may have passed the torch to Dave Grohl, and I'll let you be the judge of that, because he does a song that everyone on this show knows and loves, but he does it his way, so I'll let you call the out, but definitely give it, 30, 45 seconds.
All right.
So you can see what he ends up doing with it.
All
right. You say I only hear what I want to.
He's wearing a dress, by the way.
He looks just like this.
And glasses.
Now, you might want to turn your volume down a little. So he goes into this sort of thrash screamo and toggles back and forth.
Sell a Tessa, but okay.
All right. We
so
get it.
He has that, which is very funny. And then the second night has been released. I'm just going to play you literally just the beginning of this classic Ramones song that they do a little Jewish spin on.
Hey, oi, let's go. Hey, oi. It's funny. Let's go.
So they're really fun. They put out 8, obviously. They have these great, like, Super 8 film, you know, bat mitzvah going on in the background.
It's funny.
Last year they did Beastie Boys. They did Drake. You know, people who have some sort of affiliation with the members of the tribe. So
would
that was a lot
would
of
it kill them to do Christmas songs?
I think you're well represented, Bryan.
Oh, no. All the songs are written by Jews.
Oh, that's true.
That's a good point.
That's a very, sorry, I take it back. I did get mad at you.
Did do we have that Lisa Loeb when she was doing that event tape somewhere with the super drunken chick
woman
wandering up on stage? I don't know.
I know we have the audio. Let me see.
I'm looking for that. The audio will be fine. That'll be.
Oh, no, we got the video.
Oh, good.
That cracks me up. Lisa Loeb, who's a sweetheart.
She's playing the barbecue, too.
She's opening for Lit.
Playing a Carolla Drinks thing or fundraiser or something we did over.
A fundraiser for Garrigus.
We did over at Mark Garrigus's restaurant in downtown. And this isn't Lisa's biggest hit, but it's a song I love. It was a hit. And Drunken Chick got on stage. Drunken chick singing. She's crowding her away from the microphone, too.
Boxing around like Charles Barkley.
I know. She's a round mound of rebound.
And she's grabbing on it. Got her arm around her.
I can't remember why she was on stage.
I think she wandered.
Yeah, I was gonna say, drunk an idiot.
I don't know. I feel like she. She's so drunk.
You think someone invited her up there for that?
I think she may have been the whatever winner. Pulled the thing. All right, you got it.
Special poor needs. Lisa.
I know, but okay. It was still funny.
And Lisa's doing a corporate gig for, I'm sure, a decent amount of change. She can't be like, bitch, get the fuck out of here. She can't be a partner in the firm. You know, she can't be someone important.
Well, let's move on to another guy in the rock field who's not having such a good day. TMZ reports that the L.A. County detectives swarmed Marilyn Manson's house Monday in connection with the sexual assault investigations into his doings that we've talked about. They entered the house with a search warrant, seizing hard drives and other media storage devices. It doesn't appear he was there at the time. The findings will be brought to the county's district attorney, who will determine whether to charge Manson in this months-long investigation. Manson, we've talked about this, accused of sealing women in these soundproof booths and a myriad of other things.
Well, a couple things. I think Rose McGowan's going to come on this show.
Oh, nice.
So it's a done deal.
Don't tease me.
She's on some island somewhere, but we've been going back and forth a little bit.
Full goosebumps.
And I want to know. I mean, all the Weinstein thing. I want to know everything. But the Marilyn, we can start with Marilyn Manson, right?
Yes, we can.
Also, when guys like that end up going to prison, it's satisfying because you know, justice has been served, but also you find out what their real hair is like, which is the most important part about guys going to prison. Right. Who are a little bit older, you get to find out what their hair is really
like. Really looks like.
Phil Spector.
Yeah.
Come on. I mean, you just see it all go, it just turns white or
yeah.
gone or the wig's gone. Or I've always wanted to know, what's that hair really like?
But that's the only way to find out. They have no access
There's
to anything.
There's no other way to do it.
Yeah.
You have to be incarcerated.
That's right. Now he's going to have to do some of the tricks that the ladies do. You know, you can burn a lead pencil for eyeliner. Mm. You take Kool-Aid and you mix it with a little water, and that's your lipstick. Mm. You know, there's tricks, but he's going to have to be taught.
Don't you think he could get into the women's section, or he could? In this day when we can't judge and everything, nothing's binary.
His name's Marilyn.
Don't you think he could pull that one off? Jeremy, did you ever work with Marilyn Manson?
No. Really? Never. I've never even met the guy.
That's good for you.
But I'm not. Yeah. I think just our worlds never really cross different kind of genres. But I've heard nothing but nightmares about working with the guy. And I don't think it's any surprise to anybody that he's into some weird shit. Kind of like the... When you hear about stuff like that, you're like, duh, it's Marilyn Manson.
I know.
When you say nightmares, you mean like just as a professional, like no one wants to deal with him?
I just heard from people that have toured with him or played in his band or whatever that he's just difficult to work with. Yeah. But, you know, I don't know that firsthand. But, yeah.
You're not shocked.
I'm not surprised by it, you know?
Yeah.
Well, when he brought the, what'd he bring in? Not laudanum.
Absinthe.
Absinthe. He brought in absinthe. He brought me a present.
That's real nice.
Which a bottle of absinthe, which they didn't sell here.
With the wormwood,
illegal.
Yeah.
But he got into it pretty hard when we were doing Loveline a million years ago. And I think there may have been some substance issues as well. But look, the good news is we're going to find out what the hair is
that's
really
like. That's most important.
Yeah, the mystery be solved.
Right. Mm-hmm. And do you remember, was it Bowling for Columbine when he was interviewed by Roger Moore? Moore.
I don't, listen, Jeez. I don't, everyone goes
that's my
nuts
favorite Bond.
Everyone goes nuts when people slip up the way you
but
just
you know
did.
What I'm talking about.
I do not anymore. Thank There's you. Way too many fucking Thank names you. Out there.
Too many Bonds.
And especially because there's a movie called Roger and Me.
That's right.
So right now you're
Thank
halfway
you.
There.
You're halfway you. There.
And remember, Marilyn Manson came across as the nicest guy, quiet, mild-mannered, and people said, you know, one of the questions was, what would you tell these parents that blame you and blame your music and that it's causing all this? And he said something to the effect of, I wouldn't say anything. I would just listen to them. And just seemed so just quiet and sort of soft-hearted. And that was the impression we were left with for many years.
He's not dumb, and he's a good conversationalist, and he could be funny. Like, he was a good interview when he would come into Loveline. Mm-hmm. Like, he was a good talker, you know, so...
Just not to the ladies in the soundproof cube.
No.
Okay. Well, we have another trial starting. Jussie Smollett's trial began this week in Chicago. 3 years it's been after the former Empire actor claimed he was the victim of a hate crime. The jury was selected. Opening statements have been heard. The trial is expected to last about a week. According to the Chicago Tribune, Special Prosecutor Dan Webb said in his opening statement, the actor hired two brothers to carry out this bogus attack, and that when he reported the fake hate crime, that was the real crime. Now, Jussie's lawyer, Nenye Uche, argued that the brothers, who are the prosecutor's star witnesses, are liars who hated the actor because of who he is as a person, quote unquote, and were using him to further their own careers.
The bold strategy, Cotton.
That's right.
Right.
He faces 6 counts of disorderly conduct, up to 3 years in prison, if convicted.
Couldn't he have rounded up a couple of white guys to do the hoax?
You know,
let's at least get
convincing.
The color right.
Yeah.
Seems like this it would just be easier. White
confusing.
Guys will work for a few sandwiches from Subway.
Forgive me, but I because you spent a lot of time next to Garagos. Was it he who was floating the theory that it was the lovers, that it was a lover's quarrel, like someone was a gay, jilted lover?
I believe he called in with that.
Okay,
I think there's something like that.
Pivoting now to they hated him for who he was is, again, it's a bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see if it pays off for him.
I'm actually going to talk to Mark in about 28 minutes.
Oh, this is going to be appointment listening.
I'll ask him about it.
Because he's not, he does, his name didn't come up in this article.
Hold his feet to the fire over the lovers thing. Say, why would lovers do this to each other?
He'll, listen, he's Jen Psaki on steroids, man. He can duck
player.
And slide those questions. Yeah. And he's not, listen, when you're an attorney, if you don't want to talk about something, you just go, I wish I could.
Yeah.
But it's attorney, it's the privilege.
Gag,
you know what
order,
I mean? Like,
yeah.
I can't talk about. So right. he'll do that. He has, I think one of his associates is doing, I don't think he's doing the
is
case.
Is it Boring
Cop? He's got, no, Ben is doing other things, but it's a female that's involved.
She was singing with Lisa Loeb.
His practice, who's doing the Jussie Smollett case.
Oh,
still
interesting.
Still with his firm? Assumed it was some random
Chicago
one.
Person.
No, the last, I mean, Chris can look it up, but the last I spoke to Mark Garagos about representing Jussie Smollett is a female, dark-haired, maybe ethnic, I guess. I don't know what words we get to use
covers
anymore.
All around.
I could be Armos, you know, he hires a lot of them.
Sure.
A female was in Chicago dealing, from his firm, was dealing with Smollett. Does that sound right, Chris?
It does sound right. I just don't have her name.
Is that the thing now? Because, and I'm basing this on three cases, but all these really highly publicized cases, all of the prosecutors are female. Is that some sort of psychological thing?
Dragon lady.
Well, yeah, is that, I don't know. We were just talking about, talking about Ahmaud Arbery. We were talking about, God, who else were we just talking about?
Well, Rittenhouse wasn't, but.
No, not Rittenhouse.
They, but, look, everything is optics now.
Right.
You know, Mark can always tell you, you know, African-Americans are hard on crime, you know, so you want more African-American jurors, you know, because they're tougher.
If you're a prosecutor.
Yeah, and or females are more skewed this way,
right.
And males are more that way, and college educated this way, and you know, it's all group. I mean, they figure it all out. But what I'm saying is then it comes to the prosecutor. Yeah, when you have a guy and he's accused of rape or something like that, then they have the female attorney, because you're going, see, he's not a rape. He would have raped her.
Right.
He would have banged her in the juror's box, you know? Come on.
That's, you know, the defense.
To the best of your knowledge, has your client ever tried to rape you?
No, but it's all optics. If
right.
if you get Supreme Court nominee, back when he was Supreme Court nominee, Kavanaugh, right? You watch his press conference when they were announcing it. He's got his daughter standing behind him. He's got his wife standing behind him. And then he launches into this tirade. Well, not a tirade, but he's telling me the most important thing he does is being a coach to his daughter's soccer team and stuff, because he knows he's going to be called a rapist in the next 10 minutes.
It's the playbook. So, Anthony Weiner did the same thing.
Go out there. Yeah, but now it's whether you did it or not. It's like, let's get the ladies out here. They'll get some cover. I remember the time I was watching, I was like, what's he talking about being a soccer coach for? I'm going to fucking hear about all the cases he's won and lost and when he used to be a prosecutor.
We'll get there eventually.
No, it was all about his daughters and being a coach.
Right.
That's the most important thing.
Right.
He does. I would argue, I don't want those people in position of power. If I'm coaching your fucking daughter's 13-year-old soccer team's the most important thing
you most important role is father?
No, not for me, it doesn't crack my top 25.
Yeah. Well, if the second you start thinking you're an individual and no one can tell you what to do, you just start thinking about jury profiles, because I didn't realize I was so easily pegged, you know, like they're right on the money when
they
pick a female college. Blah, blah, blah. You are a one person.
Tina Glandian.
Okay, that checks out.
Could be Arma.
IAN.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's move over and put Bryan in the hot seat, because I'm sure this is something that you did when you were at USC. The University of Southern California has issued an apology after an offensive chant was made by the USC's student section.
I never once chanted.
Saturday night's football game against Brigham Young University.
Okay.
USC says
they got waxed in that game.
It was distasteful. They apologized to the entire BYU program. Now, most outlets did not say what the chant was, but after a little digging on Twitter, it seems that the tweet was possibly "fuck those Mormons."
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's USC?
Yep.
Wow.
So that's what Twitter is telling us, but none of the outlets would confirm.
Something tells me a lot of the guys in the field were Mormon.
I was going to say, somebody tweeted that like the quarterback, like the USC quarterback,
oh, is he Mormon?
Might be Mormon.
I know that.
It's got to be tough for the sideline reporter. Like, here they go. Let's go, Brandon. Yeah, again. That's right. They never stop at that chant these
days. Let's go, Mormons.
Well, it was funny because one of the guys tweeted, I think they're saying, let's go, Moroni. So same thing. You got to know a little bit about Mormonism for that. So a judge has blocked vaccines for a lot of healthcare workers in 10 states, Alaska, Arkansas, Iowa, Kansas, Missouri, Nebraska, New Hampshire, North Dakota, South Dakota, and Wyoming. So if you're a certain kind of healthcare worker, you do not need to get vaccinated to work, you know, where nursing home, hospital, whatever. Far cry from what's going on here in Los Angeles. I sure hope y'all are carrying your proof. And I bet it's very different where you are, Jeremy, because in LA right now, we are now enforcing strict COVID-19 vaccine proof mandates that goes for restaurants, coffee shops, gyms, movie theaters, nail salons, and other things. It's called Safe Pass LA, and it took effect on November 8th, but they gave businesses a little time to get their shit together. So fines will go $1,000 for the first one, $2,000 for the third, and $5,000 for a fourth, and then it just keeps going up from there. And the requirement is for anyone 12 and older.
How is Florida have the lowest spread of COVID right now with zero fucking anything? How's Florida? You look at the fucking map, Florida's like yellow. The rest of the country, it's all about weather. It's all about heading indoors. It's nothing to do with all their fucking rules.
And Andy and I were kind of freaked out at first because we went to Arizona for the weekend and we thought, oh, how do we do that? By the end of the weekend, I mean, you're just walking around, you know, you're outside, you're doing your thing. It didn't even dawn on us. Everybody, we're fine.
We got to get that pill that Drew's talking about.
The new Pfizer pill.
Yeah, field between.
What's the pill?
It's like you get it and you take the pill and you don't have it anymore.
No.
Some Let's version get that. Of that. Yeah, that's coming. But I don't know. All the latest reports are the vaccine. The vaccine was sold as first you get a vax and you don't have to worry about it. Then it was, well, you need a booster. But then it was, you get the vax, but you can't spread it. Or you can't get it. Now you can spread it. Now you can get it. Then the vax wears off. Now you got to get a booster. Then it got to, well, if you have the vax and you get it, it's not going to be severe, which that's starting to come undone as well.
Is it?
Yeah. Now, if you look at a lot of the stories out of like Israel and most of the data's out of Israel because they're vaxxed first and they're way ahead of us.
So I thought the whole point is you'll get it, but you're not ending up in the hospital.
Well, you got to understand, everything is sold incrementally, just like the fucking airlines. It's going to be a two-hour delay. It's going to be a 20-minute delay times five, right. 20 minutes at a time. So it's first is sold, get the vax, go about your life. Get a vax, no mask. Get a vax, go about your life. Then it's get a vax, wear a mask. Then it's get a second shot. Then it's get a booster. Then it's you're good. Then it's going to wear off. Then it's you can't get, well, you can't spread it. Then you can spread it. Well, you can get it, but you can't. It all goes incrementally. It's turning out the vaxes aren't what we were hoping they would be.
But
I mean,
do you think it's nefarious or you think it's a trial and error? Like, oh, well, I guess it didn't work the way we thought it was going to work.
It's the same with secondhand smoke. Is it nefarious? No. Is it a lie? Yes. Do they want you to do something? Yes. But they lie to you to get you to do it? Yes.
You think they knew in advance?
I think because it always goes one direction. And because
happy accident, we're all good.
They're kind of aware of what is going on before we are. I don't look at it as a, you know, deep state, whatever, but they want to sell, like, they have a plan. The plan is either quit smoking, we'll pitch you secondhand smoke, or it's get vaxxed. You don't sell get vaxxed by, you sell it as do it and go back to normal.
Right.
Like, that's the first sell. Like, do it, we all go back to normal. Then you get into this weird area of get vaxxed, because the people that are unvaxxed are a danger to you. Well, why are they a danger to you if they're unvaxxed? They're a danger to themselves, but you're vaxxed. Right. So why is your vax in, why are you in danger? Because they need to get vaxxed because they're putting you in danger because you're showing up at the same malls there. It's all done incrementally, but it's all goes one direction. It never goes the other direction.
Right.
And that's what I'm saying. So look, get vaxxed. I'm not saying don't get vaxxed. I'm just saying all of the 6 foot and the mask and all that stuff, it doesn't amount to much. You get it by going indoors. When the weather gets bad in Florida, it gets hot in Florida, everyone goes indoors, then they have a spike. Then it gets cold in the Northeast and everyone heads in, right, and then they get a spike.
Well, that's why they're saying, you know, they don't include the reason is the weather, but they say we're most concerned about the upper Midwest and the Northeast. Well,
it's all indoors. Right. It's all the weather, and it's beautiful in Florida now. People are outside. The fucking weather thing, the fact that they welded bars over the basketball hoops at the parks and bulldozed sand so people couldn't fucking play volleyball in Santa Monica, that's patently insane. And I thank Christ when I was interviewed by one of the guys from the doctor's show, and I was like, lying down on the beach was a danger. And he went, we didn't know. And you didn't know? Well, then fucking quit. You didn't fucking know. You're an infectious disease doctor. You didn't thought maybe putting a beach towel out in fucking Malibu.
Huge
you
problem.
Thought that was going to be a problem?
Arresting a paddleboarder.
Fucking fire yourself.
Yeah.
The whole outdoor thing was fucking wrong about it.
Yeah.
Should have been pushing people outdoors.
I mean, I'll talk to Mark Garagos about it, but fucking Tin Horn Flats, 2 miles away from here, has got a fence around it because they had people eating outdoors during the outdoor. All right, anyway. Thank God.
All right. Well, do we have time for one more?
Yes.
You're right. Women have lost their minds, and we keep seeing it over. We
get
saw
that drop,
we saw a woman take her own prosthetic leg off at the hockey game and beat somebody with it. The examples are endless. And a flight attendant. The job of a flight attendant keeps moving up the list of dangerous professions because of crazy drunk people. This time it's a drunk woman attacked two flight attendants on a Spirit Airlines flight on Saturday.
I would love to I'd like to talk to Orville and Wilbur Wright.
Right. Not Redenbacher.
And so could have easily done that.
Yeah.
And I'd go like, you know, it's going to be real dangerous. There's going to be commercial flights. You guys don't know what you guys invented here. Going to be actual airplanes. They're going to be sealed. Right. They'll be flying at altitude.
Majestic.
Yeah.
Every major city have a port.
And now they're going to have like waitresses on the plane. You know, like the diner has a waitress. Huh? They're going to have them on this thing that you guys created. But it's going to be one of the more dangerous professions. And they're going to like,
well, yeah, because we try and cook in the area. Yeah. Hot grease or you got open fire.
Yeah.
They're going to be, they would think the airplanes weren't safe. Aeronautically, there weren't sound.
Yeah, too many people on the plane. It'll never get off the ground.
When I was a kid, if you said airplane and safety, it was like, oh, yeah, that's what happened to Leonard Skinner.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, Steve Ray Vaughan.
Those guys who played soccer, sure. the Argentinian team. It's like, no, the planes are insanely safe. The people in them are now dangerous.
Yeah. Correct.
They're now having fist fights. The plane, no problem.
Steel bird in the sky.
Nary an accident.
The fucking drunken asshole that's in aisle 7, that's the guy's going to stab you.
Yep. So this one is an unnamed 42-year-old woman. She reportedly punched one of them and pulled the hair of another one on a 1-hour flight from Fort Lauderdale to Nashville. She was slurring when the police removed her.
Lit.
That's right. They removed her. She insisted she hadn't done anything wrong, told the cops to shoot her. She admitted to officers that she'd been doing a little day drinking.
Well, here's the thing about cops. They only shoot people who don't want to be shot.
That's right.
When you ask them to shoot you, they rarely shoot you.
Reverse psychology.
So if you're looking to get shot, keep it zip.
Yeah. She was released Sunday morning from jail. Attorney General Merrick Garland has instructed U.S. attorneys to prioritize unruly passenger cases because this ain't stopping.
Good. No, move to the top of the list.
Yeah.
There's like, I don't know, 3,000,
you know what's
5,000?
Crazy about... I really don't believe that the flight attendant's job has gotten more dangerous. I think it's gotten more ridiculous as a passenger, what they put you through.
Mm.
And I think that people are literally shoved to their wits' end by the time they even get to the boarding process of a flight, which you were supposed to board 3 hours ago, but you've been sitting, at the bar because your flight got delayed 4 times, like Adam was saying, in 20-minute increments. And then they let you on and immediately they start just treating you like such crap. And the second one comes up to you and talks to you, they've been deputized now. They've got more power than anybody. And they've got the power to literally ruin the next 4 days of your life, because you're going to get off the plane. You're going to have to take a shuttle somewhere an hour away, pay for your own. They don't give vouchers anymore for hotels and shit like that. So just you're just at the mercy of people that hate their jobs. They're miserable. They're working 8 days a week and 25 hours a day. And they're fed up. Passengers are fed up. And it's like this perfect storm. I say this because we travel almost every single weekend.
Yeah. What do you know?
And it's just gotten to a point where, I don't know what people
the humanity is gone.
I think what we need to do is go, look, getting from LA to Phoenix for $39 is fine, and getting to Maui for $129, we got to add $50 on. Right. Yeah. We got to thin it out a little bit. We need a little extra 4 inches of space. Mm-hmm. Like, we need a little more humanity. Can we all just agree we'll pay an extra 8% on our ticket, because it's turning into a bus.
Yeah.
I mean, it's essentially the price. It's such a competition for the price. And then when the price, in order to do the price, you have to have one person for every 39 people on the plane, not two people, or one person for every 20 people on the plane. And the lines get longer and you get herded more, and everyone starts having that feeling before they even got on the plane. Like, can we all just agree to pay a little extra? I was talking to Heather Dubrow.
Ooh.
From The Real Housewives or whatever, and her plastic surgeon, whatever.
Yeah, husband.
And they're like, oh, when we go to LAX, we don't even go in. There's a whole service where you just park outside of the airport for $1,500. Yep. And
Wasn't it special terminal?
Not the one that's in the airport.
No,
there is a special door in the airport. Yeah, yeah. This is, you don't go into the airport.
You go full Burbank and go right onto the tarmac?
You park somewhere outside the airport. You sit in a lounge. They serve you drinks. You get in a BMW four-door and they drive out onto the tarmac.
Well, I definitely don't know about this.
I don't know. Holy, you got to look it up, Chris. And I was like, of course you're in a good mood. You're $1,500 lighter in the pocket. But that's making my point, which is you throw some money at it and they're never in a bad, like, they were literally, I was talking to, we were in Orange County, and they're like, we got to go to LAX tomorrow. And I was like, oh, that's a bummer. I got to get up early and fight that. No. We look forward to it. Like, I mean, so money can work.
Yeah.
Well, we've all done Jet Suite X, right?
We've all
done that.
No, we all haven't done Jet Suite X.
Well, my point, Gene, is it's not that much more than a regular flight. Right. It's like 50 to 60% more. It's more.
It varies.
But it's not like break the bank, $10,000. Right. No, it's $340.
No one argues. No one's in a bad mood. Right. People are playing foosball before you get on the flight. Right, just, there is no tension. There's no hostility. Which is when you herd people and you put them in line and, have the snarky person behind the counter who's, by the way, on her last nerve because she's tired of talking to you assholes, and everyone is pre-agitated.
Yes.
All right, let's bring it home.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news. Fuck those Mormons.
Oh, no. Gina Grad.
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Gina.
Max Zapata, what is that thing called? I think it's a terminal. It's outside LAX. It's got some roads or some sort of euphemistic whatever. It's not even euphemistic, but it was so funny. You know, when you talk to rich people, and they're like, yeah, it's only $1,500, and me and Drew were like, oh, hey, it's $1,500. And then they laughed. They were like, no fucking way. It's $1,500. I can barely afford the Chick-fil-A in the terminal. They're like, you park, you have a drink, you relax, they put the music on, and somehow they drive you onto the tarmac.
Sounds awesome.
And then you just get out and hand them your luggage. Here's your
bag. I'll take that for you, sir.
Must be nice.
Yeah. I don't know. We can look for it, or Drew will tell me.
Yeah, I'm saying it's called P.S.
Down to try it.
I don't know what it stands for, but yeah, it's a VIP, secret VIP terminal.
$1,500 research fee.
Just not having to pull into the horseshoe at LAX. It's not having to hit the traffic and the honking. You try to drop someone off, they're someone up your ass. Oh,
the
cops
mad at you. Yep.
Right. Yep.
Yeah, the private suites cost $4,350 per visit, includes access for up to four travelers.
Oh, so maybe they were breaking it down.
Yeah, 1,500 apiece.
They were also explaining to me why 13,000 square feet is not a very big house.
Interesting.
That's another argument I'm having with them.
What's the reasoning?
They're like, we're building a place in Montana. We'll probably get there a couple weekends out of the year. I'm like, oh, so it's like a cabin fishing? Well, 13,000 square foot.
Jesus.
What do you mean 13? Oh, no, it's not that big. It is.
I can still hear him when I shout across.
13,000 square feet.
It's especially big.
It's a super big house. And they're like, well, our house is 22,000 square feet. I'm like, I get it.
It's almost 10 times the size of my house.
I don't know if Chris said this, but PS stands for private suite. So it's the private suite entrance.
That's what it was. All right, let me tell you last but not least about Trico. Over a century ago, Trico was the first to make wiper blades. They've been a step ahead of Mother Nature ever since. Trico engineers study your specific driving conditions to make sure you're ready for just about anything, even if it rains actual cats and dogs. And whatever the weather, Trico wipers maintain maximum windshield contact no matter what your driving habits are. And you'll always find the right blade for your vehicle, is Brian's uncle. That's who right. knows his way around a pick apart. Don't get wiper blades from the picker.
No, pick the apart. One thing he demands that I buy new.
Trico wiper blades. And they're the future of wipers since 1917. You can find a store near you and see their latest offers. To do that, you visit tricocatsanddogs.com. That is tricocatsanddogs.com. The podcast, My Own Worst Enemy, the podcast, a four-parter, the single Yeah, 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 the website, litband.com, Carolla Barbecue. Well, the tickets start December 6th at carolladrinks.com, and that'll include, you'll included with the tickets, you'll sign up for the wine club as well. So come on out and see Lit in person 2022. Jeremy, thanks for joining us, my friend.
Dude, always a pleasure, man. Thanks for having me. We go back a long ways to the Love Wine days and
I know.
Bringing bottles of Jaeger in there, and we were doing that.
Always good to talk to you and see you, my friend.
Yeah, you too, brother.
So, until next
time. Appreciate y'all.
Adam Crowford, TJ Miller, and Jeremy Popoff, and Gina Grant, and Bob Ryan, say it. Mahalo.
Seth Rogen. I love Seth Rogen. He's been on the show a few times.
What happened?
Yeah, Caitlin's taking pictures with Seth Rogen, like when he was in here, and I guess he came in when Caitlin worked at the Coffee Bean.
Oh my God, that's Caitlin!
I didn't know it was possible for Caitlin to look younger
and prettier.
Yeah,
look at that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway,
she's gorgeous.